Welcome back again. So today we will study the next bone of upper limb, that is the humerus. Now this is the humerus bone. Humerus bone is the only bone which is present in the arm. So it is the bone of arm of upper limb. It is present in the arm of upper limb. Now it is a long bone. As it is a long bone, it is having two ends and a body. The body is also called as shaft, and it is having two ends. This portion is the shaft, and one and two, these are the two ends of humerus. Now taking all, how to identify the upper end and lower end, and some general features of all these structures. First of all, the upper end. Now upper end, it is spheroidal in shape because it is having a head. This one, the spheroidal shape structure, it is the head. Just succeeding the head, the constricted portion is called as neck of humerus. After neck, two tubercles are present on the upper end. One is the lesser tubercle, this prominency, it is the lesser tubercle. And one, this one, broad one, second prominency, it is the greater tubercle. So these all structures are present onto the upper end. On the lower end, when you see the lower end, lower end is flattened antero-posteriorly. See like this. It is flattened antero-posteriorly and widened transversely. On the lower end, two articular surfaces are present. One is the capitulum and another one is the trochlea. The pulley-shaped structure is called as trochlea and the rounded structure is called as capitulum. Above these two structures, some depressions are present, fossas are present. Above the trochlea, this depression is called as coronoid fossa, and above the capitulum, the depression is called as radial fossa. We will repeat these structures or features again, but for now, this is the trochlea and this is the capitulum. This is the coronoid fossa and this is the radial fossa. Also, two prominences are present on the sides. This is medial epicondyle and this one is lateral epicondyle. When we see from the posterior aspect, again a depression is present, a large depression which is called as olecranon fossa. So these structures are present on the lower end. On the upper end, we can see the head, neck, two tubercles. Now, when talking about the shaft is somewhat cylindrical in shape on the upper part, and as we go downwards, it is triangular in shape. So these are the some of the, and the shaft is having three borders and three surfaces. Now these were the some identifying features of humerus, and on the basis of these identifying features, we can determine the side of humerus. First point of determination is the position of head. Now head of humerus, it is directly directed medially backwards and slightly upwards. So we have to keep the position of head facing medially. Also in anatomical position, it is somewhat backwards and upwards. And the lesser tubercle, this small prominency, it is anteriorly. Greater is posterior lateral and lesser tubercle is present anteriorly. So on the basis of these two structures, we can determine the side of humerus. I am repeating again, the head faces medially, backwards and slightly upwards. Remember the position of glenoid cavity of scapula. Opposite to that, the position of head of humerus is there. And the lesser tubercle is present onto the anterior side. So this humerus is of right side. I have to hold this in right hand. The head is medially and the lesser tubercle is anteriorly. So this humerus is of right side. After that, we come to the general features and attachments present on the humerus. First, about the upper end. As we have seen, that upper end is having head, neck, two tubercles. Now, head, this spheroidal shaped structure is the head of humerus and it articulates with the glenoid cavity of scapula to form shoulder joint, which is also called as glenohumeral articulation. That joint is ball and socket variety of synovial joint. Now, as it is a synovial joint, The capsule is attached. Here, the capsule is attached onto the anatomical neck of humerus. Now, what is anatomical neck? I told earlier that the constricted portion just beyond the head. This portion is the constricted portion and it is called as anatomical neck of humerus. Now, apart from anatomical neck, two more necks are present in humerus. One is morphological neck and another one is surgical neck. Now, what is morphological neck? The line which passes through the lower margin of lesser and greater tubercle and enclosing the whole upper end like this, enclosing the circle. This is the morphological neck. You can define morphological neck by saying that it is the line of fusion between epiphysis and diaphysis. The line of fusion between the shaft and the upper end, that is the epiphysis and the diaphysis, is called as morphological neck. Now, third type of neck is called as surgical neck. Surgical neck is the junction where the upper expanded upper end meets the cylindrical shaft, that is this point. Like this. Now, in between both the necks, morphological and surgical neck, around 0.5 mm difference is only present. These are 0.5 mm apart from each other. And what is the importance of surgical neck, or why it is called a surgical neck? Because this is the most common point of fracture of humerus. This is the point where the humerus fractures commonly. And here some important structures are related as axillary nerve and anterior posterior circumflex humeral vessels. So these three structures are related to the surgical neck. If this point of humerus get fractured, then these three structures are entangled, and this is very important to surgeons. That's why this is called as surgical neck of humerus. So three necks: anatomical, morphological and surgical neck. Now we again get back to the attachment of capsule. Capsule is attached onto the anatomical neck on the whole margin except at two points. The two points are, first, superiorly on the anatomical neck, the capsule is deficient. Now, why it is deficient? Because the long head of biceps brachii, the tendon of long head of biceps brachii, passes through this gap. As told in the video of scapula, the origin of long head of biceps brachii is intracapsular. So, the tendon first runs inside the capsule, then it passes through this gap to pass onto this groove, and then the muscle overlaps, or muscle is present in the arm. So this capsule is deficient here for the passage of tendon of biceps brachii muscle. Second exception, near to the medial surface, the capsule dips down for around 2 cm to enclose the surface of the shaft of humerus, like this. Here, this the capsule dips down, so it also encloses, or the some upper part of the shaft of humerus is intracapsular. So this is the attachment of capsule of shoulder joint on the anatomical neck of humerus. After that, we come to the lesser tubercle. Lesser tubercle is the prominent short projection present anteriorly. It is having one muscular impression, and on that muscular impression, insertion of subscapularis muscle takes place. The subscapularis muscle is inserted on the lesser tubercle. Then on the greater tubercle, three muscular impressions are present, and three muscular impressions are like this. One is superiorly, then second one is intermediate, and third one is inferiorly. On the superior one, supraspinatus is inserted, then on the intermediate, infraspinatus is inserted, and below that, on the third one, teres minor is inserted, and its insertion extending onto the shaft of humerus also. So three muscles, supraspinatus, infraspinatus and teres minor. You can remember by the mnemonic SIT, S-I-T. Next, on the prominent margins of both the tubercle, superior side, here a ligament is attached, which is called as transverse humeral ligament. Transverse humeral ligament. It bridges the gap between these two tubercles and keeps in position the tendon of biceps brachii, which is coming superiorly like this. So it keeps or holds the tendon of biceps brachii intact in position in this groove, upper part of this groove. Now this groove, the groove is called as bicipital groove, also called as intertubercular sulcus because it is present between the two tubercles, and as the tendon of biceps brachii is passing biceps, so it is also called as bicipital groove. Now as it is a groove or sulcus, it is having two lips and a floor. Two lips are the margin, prominent margin of both the tubercles extending downward onto the shaft also. This is the medial margin and this is the lateral margin. Floor is the depressed portion of bone between the two lips. Now attachment on these margins, onto the medial margin, lower two-third part of medial margin, teres major muscle is inserted, teres major. Onto the lower three-fourth margin of the lateral lip, pectoralis major muscle is inserted. Pectoralis major muscle insertion extends downwards and it merges with the insertion of deltoid muscle. We will come to it later. Deltoid muscles insertion till it extends up till that insertion. On the floor, another muscle is inserted, which is called as latissimus dorsi. On the medial lip, teres major. On the lateral lip, pectoralis major. Pectoralis major muscle insertion is bilaminar in nature. And on the floor, latissimus dorsi. There are structures passing through this groove. First one, we have talked it about many times, the tendon of biceps brachii muscle. And another structure which is again passing from this groove is ascending branch of circumflex humeral artery. It passes like this. Now, you can learn these three names by a mnemonic, lady between two majors. Lady means latissimus dorsi. Between two majors, majors are pectoralis major and teres major. Pectoralis is away and teres is towards the body. So this is all about the upper end. After that, we come to the shaft. Shaft is cylindrical in upper part and triangular in lower part. And it is having three borders and three surfaces. The three borders are anterior border, medial border, and the lateral border, and the three surfaces are anteromedial surface, anterolateral surface, and the posterior surface. Now, first of all, the anterior border. Anterior border starts as the lateral lip of the bicipital groove runs downwards and finishes just above the lower end. The lateral border. Lateral border is somewhat indistinct in its upper part. In the middle of this border, it is crossed by a spiral groove. And then in the lower part, it is sharp, edge-like. And that sharp, edge-like part is called as lateral supracondylar line. As it is present just above the epicondyles, so it is called as supracondylar line. And on the lateral side, so lateral supracondylar line. The medial border. The medial border starts from below the lesser tubercle. It is rounded and then in the lower portion, it continues as the medial supracondylar line. Now the three surfaces, first of all, the anterolateral surface lying between the anterior and the lateral border. In the center of this surface, a V-shaped tuberosity is present, which is called as deltoid tuberosity. And on the deltoid tuberosity, insertion of deltoid muscle takes place. The upper part of shaft above this tuberosity is covered by deltoid muscle only. Now below the deltoid tuberosity, this surface gives origin to brachialis muscle. Like this. Now on this lateral border, the lateral intermuscular septum is attached. So on the lateral side, deltoid is inserted, brachialis muscle is taking origin from the lower part of the surface, and on the lateral border, lateral intermuscular septum is attached, which is separating the anterior compartment of arm from the posterior compartment, and the septum is attached onto the supracondylar line or ridge also. Then we come to the anteromedial surface. Anteromedial surface present between the anterior border and the medial border. In the middle of this surface, a rough ridge is present which gives insertion to coracobrachialis muscle. Below, the lower part also gives origin to brachialis muscle, just like anterolateral surface. So brachialis muscle takes origin from whole of this part. Coracobrachialis is inserted here. Also on this surface, nutrient foramen is present here. The foramen is lying here on the anteromedial surface, and the direction of nutrient foramen is towards pointing downwards. That means the artery is entering like this. It is pointing towards the lower end. Then on the medial border, the medial intermuscular septum is attached, just similar to the lateral border, extending also onto this line. Then comes the posterior surface. Posterior surface gives attachment to the muscles of posterior compartment of arm. Also here, as I told earlier, a spiral groove is present, which is traversing the lateral border, which is interrupting the lateral border. From this spiral groove, just above that, a ridge is present, and from this ridge, the lateral head of triceps brachii takes origin. Like this. Now, from this groove is called as a spiral groove, also called as radial groove, and from the radial groove, radial nerve is passing. With the radial nerve, profunda brachii artery is also traversing the groove. Now below this groove, whole of the posterior surface gives origin to the medial head of triceps brachii muscle. So onto the posterior surface, only the lateral head and the medial head of triceps muscle are taking origin. Between the origin of these two muscles, a groove is present, which is called as a spiral or radial groove, and from that, the radial nerve and the profunda brachii vessels are passing. After that, we come back again to the supracondylar line. There are two supracondylar lines, the medial and the lateral. Both of them are giving attachment to the intermuscular septums of the corresponding side. Apart from the septum, the medial supracondylar line plus the accompanying surface is giving origin to the pronator teres muscle. The lateral supracondylar line in its upper two-third part gives origin to the brachioradialis muscle, and its lower one-third part gives origin to the extensor carpi radialis longus muscle. On the medial side, pronator teres, and on the lateral side, upper brachioradialis, then extensor carpi radialis longus. After that, we come to the lower end, this one. The lower end is flattened anteroposteriorly and it is widened transversely. The lower end comprises of both articular and non-articular parts. First of all, the articular parts. The articular part are the trochlea, which is fully shaped in the structure, and the capitulum, which is rounded structure. These two parts articulate with ulna and radius, the capitulum with the head of radius, and the trochlea with the trochlear notch of ulna to form the elbow joint. Elbow joint is a compound joint because three bones are participating in it, and it is a type of hinge variety of synovial joint. So this part participate in the formation of elbow joint. Also, articular part includes these two fossas, which are called as radial and coronoid fossa, and a fossa present onto the posterior aspect, which is called as olecranon fossa. Now, during full extension of forearm, the olecranon process of ulna rests in this fossa. That's why it is called as olecranon fossa. During full extension of forearm, the head of radius rests in this fossa. That's why it is called as radial fossa. And the coronoid process of ulna rests in this fossa. That's why it is called as coronoid fossa. So these three fossas comes into action when there is full flexion or full extension of forearm. Now the attachment of capsule, as the elbow joint is a synovial joint, so capsule is attached. The capsule is attached onto the margins of trochlea and capitulum, enclosing all the three fossas inside. Like this. Now, one important thing to note here, we can see that the trochlea is having two lips, the medial lip and the lateral lip. And we can also see that the medial lip is projecting downwards. It is around 6 millimeter down than the medial lip. And due to this difference of both the lips or flanges of trochlea, an angle is formed in human beings, which is called as carrying angle. Carrying angle during full extension of forearm and with the hand supinated like this, the angle formed between the arm and the forearm, it is open outwards. It is open outwards and it is around 170 degrees in male, in human beings, and it is more in females as compared to males. The importance of this angle is to keep the upper limb away from the trunk. And it is more in females because females are having wider pelvis. So this angle is called as carrying angle, open outwards, and it is around 165 to 170 degree. The range is from 165 to 170 degrees. So this is the carrying angle. After that comes the non-articular part of lower end, which are the epicondyles. This is the medial epicondyle and this is the lateral epicondyle. The lateral epicondyle is a smaller, it is a prominence, bony prominence, but it is rounded. Whereas the medial epicondyle is more prominent. You can easily feel the medial epicondyle and the lateral epicondyles on the elbow. Medial epicondyle is more prominent, more sharp as compared to the lateral epicondyle. The attachments or the relations of these epicondyles, on the lateral one, in front, the supinator muscle takes origin, plus the common superficial extensor tendons. The common tendon for all the superficial extensors of forearm takes origin from the front of this epicondyle. From the posterior aspect, anconeus muscle takes origin. So laterally, three muscles, the supinator and the common origin of extensors of forearm, posteriorly the anconeus. On the medial epicondyle, from the front, the common origin of flexors, superficial flexors of forearm. From behind the medial epicondyle, a faint groove is present on which a nerve is related, which is called as ulnar nerve. Ulnar nerve here is subcutaneous and it can be easily rolled out here. Now, ulnar nerve is related directly on this bone. You can easily feel that nerve and you can easily tingle that nerve, and that's why this bone is called as humerus bone, because of the tingling sensation caused due to the rolling out of ulnar nerve. This bone is called as humerus bone. So three nerves are related onto the humerus bone. First is this one, second I told earlier radial nerve, and third onto the surgical neck, the axillary nerve. Sometimes a hook shaped process appears around 5 cm above the medial condyle here. Sometimes there is a hook like process. It is not present in this bone, but sometimes a hook like process arises around 5 cm above the medial epicondyle, and that process is called as supracondylar process. So it is hooked and it projects downwards. From the supracondylar process to the medial epicondyle, a fibrous band is attached, and that fibrous band is a part of pronator teres muscle only, and that fibrous band is called as Struthers ligament. After the formation of that fibrous band and hook-like process, a foramen is created here, which is called as supracondylar foramen, and from that foramen, the median nerve and brachial artery passes. It is a variation. It is not present in every human being. It is sometimes present, and when it is present, then the median nerve and brachial artery passes through that foramen. So this was all about humerus, the ossification and the clinical feature, and one angle which is called as angle of humeral torsion will be explained in next video. Hope you all like the video. Thank you for watching.